Welcome to the YouTube channel created by Dr. VRR Government Degree College, Jajala. And today we are going to discuss a small topic related to the neural synapse and synaptic transmission. So let's get started. The contents of today's discussion are the definition of synapse and the types of synapse, structure of chemical and electrical synapses, synaptic transmission mechanism, synaptic transmission types, the direct synaptic transmission and indirect synaptic transmission, the neurotransmitters, examples, and the termination of chemical transmission, how the neurotransmitters get removed from the synaptic cleft. Okay. Friends, you may be knowing very well that synapse is nothing but a junction between two neurons. The two neurons communicate with one another with the help of a very, very important structure called synapse. Many authors describe synapse as a small gap between the two neurons. It is a structural gap, but it is a very, very important functional bridge between the two neurons. So, the physical connection between the two neurons is with a small gap. We call that gap as the functional bridge, and that is called a synapse. Synapses are part and parcel of our nervous system, and they are very, 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 very important structures for neural integration. So, integration of a neural activity means some signals are to be passed to the next neuron, some are not to be passed to the next neuron. But you know, the electrical activity, what has happened earlier, in earlier video we have seen, once the action potential is initiated, it renews itself and it will go till it touches the last part. In the middle, it never stops. So, if it is to be regulated, there must be a structure. That structure is called synapse. Synapse regulates the flow of action potential to the next neuron. Some action potentials are allowed to go to the next neuron. That means the action potential is excited, and some are inhibited. Some are not allowed to go to the next neuron. That's why the neural integrity is dependent upon the healthy functioning of synapses. And why to study synapse? It is established that if a neuron is having more synapses, the neuron is said to be learnt something. Learning is directly involved in the formation of these synapses. A neuron has many synapses, for example. That neuron has got lot of information. That neuron has got lot of memory. Okay. So, memory, learning, these are all related to the formation of synapses. By studying the synapse, or by understanding the mechanism of synapse, by understanding the formation of a new synapse on a particular neuron, we can understand the mechanism of learning. We can understand the mechanism of memory. That's very, very important. Not only this, most of the drugs, if we say hard drugs, or most of the drugs are directly linked to the functioning of synapse. Some drugs are all excitatory in nature. They go and settle inside the synaptic cleft and continuously excite the postsynaptic neurons so that we get a feeling of hallucinations. Or some are sedatives, some are painkillers. So these drugs are directly showing their effect on synapses, because there are some of the proteins involved to secrete neurotransmitters. There are certain proteins which act as receptors at the site of synapse. These drugs are directly what is that called, influencing the proteins which are going to produce the neurotransmitter or the receptors. So that's why to understand the effect of the drugs, we need to understand the mechanism of synaptic transmission, synaptic structure. What is a synapse? Synapse is the reason between the two neurons. It is the junction between the two neurons. It is a structural gap between the two neurons and the functional bridge between the two neurons. Okay. A synapse has certain structures. So before, if you see a synapse, so above the synapse, there is a neuron where from the information comes, that is called presynaptic neuron. And after the synapse, there is another one neuron, and that receives the information, that is called postsynaptic neuron. In between the presynaptic and postsynaptic neuron, there is a gap, that is called synaptic cleft. Of course, the synaptic cleft in the case of electrical synapse is very, very narrow, but that of a chemical synapse is somewhat widened. Okay, a synapse involves presynaptic membrane or presynaptic bowden or presynaptic bulb and synaptic cleft and also postsynaptic membrane. These three structures are the structural components of a synapse. Okay, let's see its illustration. You observe this slide. Here there is a neuron and here there is another neuron. The two neurons are physically connected with one another in this area. So the area where the two neurons are physically contacted with one another is called a synapse. Okay. So the neuron which is situated prior to the attachment is called presynaptic neuron. And that neuron which is there after the attachment or after the junction is called postsynaptic neuron. So, where is the synapse? Synapse is in between presynaptic neuron and a postsynaptic neuron. A presynaptic neuron, you see here, is having several boutons, several bulbs at its axon terminals. Axon terminal is actually branched. Okay, many branches are there and each branch is having a bouton or having a bulb-like structure. That is called presynaptic bulb. Okay, this presynaptic bulb, if you can observe here carefully, is establishing a contact, physical contact with the soma or with another dendrite like that. Okay, so that area, that specific area is called a synapse. It may be pronounced as synapse also. Okay, a synapse is having presynaptic neuron, synaptic cleft, and postsynaptic neuron. Postsynaptic neuron especially, the postsynaptic membrane. Okay, synapse is a structural gap, but it is the functional bridge. And neurons make physical contact with each other with the help of a small cleft or a small gap, that is called synapse. Let's see the types of synapses. Synapses can be categorized or classified on two particular things. On the basis of contact, these are classified into three types. Okay, on the basis of functioning, they are classified into three types. Okay, let us first understand what are the different types of synapses on the basis of their contact. Okay, contact between presynaptic and postsynaptic. This is a presynaptic neuron. You just see here, presynaptic neuron is having terminal dendrite or terminal branches of axon, and this is bulged one. This is called bouton. Now, this neuron is called postsynaptic neuron. The postsynaptic neuron is having dendrites. Presynaptic neuron is attached to one of the dendrites of postsynaptic neuron. So, the synapse is established here in between the, what is that called, axon of presynaptic neuron, dendrite of postsynaptic neuron. So, based on this data, the name of the synapse, the nomenclature of this synapse is axodendritic synapse. dendritic synapse, because the presynaptic axon is establishing a synapse with the postsynaptic dendrite, axodendritic synapse. Let's see the other variety. This is presynaptic neuron. Its axon terminal making a contact with the soma directly. So what is this called? Axosomatic. Axosomatic synapse. Axodendritic synapse. Axosomatic synapse. Now let us see the other case. This is the presynaptic neuron and this is the postsynaptic neuron. The terminal part of its axon, presynaptic neuron axon, is having a contact with the axon of postsynaptic neuron. Two axons are communicated with one another with the help of a synapse, and that synapse is called axo-axonic synapse. Say, what are the three types of synapses on the basis of their contact? One is called axodendritic, axosomatic, axo-axonic synapses. Sometimes, if you see, the synapse is established between a neuron and a nerve, what is that called, a muscle fiber. If a junction is there in between the neuron and a muscle fiber or myofibril, and such a junction is called neuromuscular junction or myoneuronal junction, we can say in any way. You see here, this is a neuron's terminal part. This is called presynaptic bouton. This is terminal bouton of motor neuron. This is because motor neuron will bring orders from the central nervous system to the muscles or to the glands. Okay, how is the connection between a motor neuron? Motor end plate, this is, we also call this as a motor end plate. So, a motor neuron, how is it contacted with a muscle? Let us see. A muscle, this is called skeletal muscle. A skeletal muscle is having, what is that called, sarcolemma. This is Z lines, this is a T-tubule actually. Okay, so you can see the T-tubule in the case of some animals, it is there. Nearby the Z line. Okay, so this is the sarcomere and this is called sarcolemma. This sarcolemma is acting as postsynaptic membrane here, and this is presynaptic. So between a motor neuron and sarcolemma, they are established a synapse, a junction. This junction is known as neuromuscular junction. Okay, you will find here a gap and you will find ACH, that means acetylcholine, the neurotransmitter, and every presynaptic bouton is having some mitochondria, because for the synaptic transmission energy is needed. That energy is produced by mitochondria. These are presynaptic vesicles, and calcium ions are also there. Calcium ions need to release the the neurotransmitter into the cleft. Okay, and when sarcolemma gets depolarized, this is the sarcolemma, when nerve impulse comes, it gets depolarized. This depolarization wave passes through the T-tubule, and the T-tubule is having cisternae. Cisternae release the calcium ions, and these calcium ions will change some configurations of myosin tubule, and also it will open the active sites of actin filaments, and we will see that discussion of muscle contraction by sliding filament theory in the next video lesson. Okay, this is a neuromuscular junction. This is also a synapse. Now, types of synapse on the basis of the function. On the basis of function, not contact. Let me correct it. On the basis of function, this is. Okay. So, on the basis of function, the synapses are classified into three types. Okay, I have shown here only the two. One is called the electric synapse, the other one is the chemical synapse, the third one is a mixture of both, that is called a mixed synapse. A mixed synapse, say a terminal bouton, at one part it is directly contacted with the postsynaptic neuron. At the other part, there is a small cleft establishing chemical synapse. That is called a mixed synapse. Okay. Based on the function, the synapses are two types. Electrical synapse or electric synapse, chemical synapse. Let us see the electrical synapse or electric synapse. Electrical synapse. This is the presynaptic bulb. The presynaptic bulb is having mitochondria. What is the definition of electrical synapse here? You see, the presynaptic membrane and the postsynaptic membrane are almost all attached with one another with a very, very narrow cleft, having only 2 nanometer, thickness. Only a 2 nanometer gap is there between these two neurons, and the presynaptic structure and postsynaptic structures are directly contacted with one another with the gap junctions. Whatever materials are there in presynaptic neuron directly go into the postsynaptic neuron when channels get opened. Okay, so that there is a direct contact. The gap is very, very narrow. And because when action potential comes into the presynaptic neuron, directly it will go into the postsynaptic neuron without any delay. There will be no delay at all. So you can see here, this is the presynaptic neuron and this is the postsynaptic one. And the gap is very, 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 very less, that is 2 nanometers. And directly there are some gap junctions. These gap junctions are ion channels. And because ions like sodium, potassium, chloride, like that, when ions are there, ions will directly go into the postsynaptic neuron. And whatever function or whatever potential they are causing in the presynaptic neuron, immediately they also cause in the next neuron. Okay, so that is the nature of electric synapse, and we are going to see the details in next slide. And this is a chemical synapse, a small representation of chemical synapse. The chemical synapse is having presynaptic bulb or presynaptic bouton, but here the presynaptic bouton is having some synaptic vesicles which are not there here. Because the synaptic vesicles contain chemicals, they are called neurotransmitters. Necessity of neurotransmitters is there for chemical synapse but not required for electrical synapse. Directly ions directly go into the next one, but here that will not occur. There is a chemical. That chemical gradually spreads across the cleft, and cleft is very wide here, having 20 nanometers. Here the gap is only 2 nanometers, but here 20 nanometer gap is there, and across this cleft a chemical passes. So, for passing of chemical, some time is needed so that when information, if it jumps to the postsynaptic neuron from the presynaptic neuron, it will be delayed. A small delay occurs. Okay, some 0.8 milliseconds of delay will occur. So, a chemical synapse always function with the delay. Electrical synapse will function without delay. There is no delay. Okay, so based on the function, these are two types. Let us discuss each and every one. Now, electrical synapse. You see, the electric synapse transmits the impulses directly. Synaptic cleft is very, very narrow with only 2 nanometers width. And there are gap junctions, ionic channels. These intercellular, this is one cell, this is the other cell, intercellular channels located between the two neurons, presynaptic and postsynaptic neurons. Okay, as they are directly communicating without any intermediary agent. Here intermediary agent neurotransmitter is there. As they are directly communicating, and this junction is called a communicating junction. Now, the channels, what are there here? The channels. The channels, whenever the action potential comes, the channels are get ready immediately to allow all the ions to flow from presynaptic to postsynaptic neuron. Not only the ions, sugar molecules and nucleotides, some second messengers like cyclic AMPs, they also move directly from presynaptic to postsynaptic. No delay, there is no delay. And such kind of electric synapses are necessary for conducting the information very, very fast without any delay. You will find these kind of electric synapses in cardiac muscles, where you will find so many gap junctions. Based on the working mechanism of electrical synapse, these electric synapses are two types, bidirectional and rectifying. understand it carefully, listen to me carefully. This is called bidirectional one, and the other one is called rectifying synapse. What is the difference? Because the two neurons contacted with one another without any gap or with a very narrow gap, there is the chance of movement of ions from top to bottom and bottom to top, okay, in forward direction and also in backward direction, vice versa. So the information can come from one neuron to another neuron or from the second neuron to the first neuron. So information moves in both directions because this is electrical synapse, okay. And such kind of synapses you will find in the cerebral, internuncial neurons. So in the cerebral internuncial neurons, they are connected with electric synapses, and movement of impulse can be in any direction. But if any electrical synapse allows the movement or the flow of information in only one direction, action potential moves in only one direction, such an electrical synapse is called rectifying synapse. A rectifying synapse will permit the electric current only in one direction. And electrical synapses are very, very essential for conducting the information very fast in such a cases where the animal has to escape from its predators. Or when an animal wants to move very fast, if delay occurs, a lot of danger occurs, the predator will catch this one. So that's why without any delay, some of the actions, some of the stereotyped behaviors are to be performed. Okay, to perform or to elicit the stereotyped behavior, or to make the animal move very, very quickly. You take, for example, a fish. Okay, a fish makes a sudden flip of its tail to change the direction. In such a case, electrical synapses are needed. And electrical synapses are formed by the giant neurons of certain crustaceans, molluscans, and also certain insects. Some giant neurons are there whose diameter is very large, and more information comes and it will be quickly conveyed to the next neuron without any delay. That is the significance of electrical synapse. Okay, let's see about the chemical synapse. A chemical synapse transmits the impulses in the form of chemicals. And these chemicals are called neurotransmitters. These neurotransmitters are synthesized in the soma, in the cell body. And after the synthesis, they are packed, they are packaged. And these packs or packages gradually move towards the tip of the axon, and they get stored for some time in the presynaptic bulb in the form of vesicles. These vesicles are called presynaptic vesicles. They store neurotransmitter chemicals. Okay. And chemical synapses are most abundant when compared to the electrical synapses. These are more abundant. And you will find a very wide gap between the two neurons in the synapse. This is called synaptic cleft, having the width of 20 nanometers. The communication between the two neurons occur here with the help of chemicals. Where are these chemicals synthesized? In the soma. They are called neurotransmitters. They are packaged and they are transported to the presynaptic bulb. Okay. And mitochondria are also there. Mitochondria, because for synaptic transmission, energy is needed. This energy is produced in mitochondria. Okay. And how does the impulse jumps from presynaptic to postsynaptic neuron? That is called synaptic transmission. And in all cases, what is this? The chemical synapse is always unidirectional in transmitting the impulse. It is only unidirectional from presynaptic neuron to postsynaptic neuron only. So friends, you might have noticed some differences between electrical synapse and chemical synapse. Here there are electrical synapse, no chemicals. Here there are chemicals. Here gap is very, very less. Here gap is more. Here gap junctions, channels are there directly. Here receptors are there. These receptors allow the channels to open only when they receive neurotransmitters. Okay, receptor ligand gated channels are there, and here what are they? Gap junctions are there. Gap junctions means directly pipelines between the two neurons. Pipelines are there. So here receptor gates are there, ligand gated channels are there. When a chemical comes, then only the gate will open. Here directly it will open. So these are the differences. Okay, right. How the synaptic transmission occurs? This is a very, very important thing. Okay, an action potential has come. It occurs in several steps. Okay, an action potential reached the tip of the axon, that is called presynaptic bulb. Whenever an action potential comes, what happens? The membrane of presynaptic bulb gets depolarized. Okay, when it is depolarized, the calcium ions enter into the presynaptic bulb, because the depolarization causes the calcium ligand channels to get open, so that the calcium channels open. Whenever the calcium channels are open, then what happens? Calcium enters inside. When calcium goes into the presynaptic bulb, they react with the synaptic vesicles having neurotransmitter. These synaptic vesicles come in contact with the presynaptic membrane, and at some special regions there are certain proteins called docking proteins. So at the site of docking proteins, these presynaptic vesicles come and fuse with the presynaptic membrane. Once they are there freely in the presynaptic bulb, when they receive calcium ions, the presynaptic vesicle now comes in contact with the presynaptic membrane and get fused with that. Not all regions, only at the region where there are certain proteins, docking proteins we call. Okay, so whenever it fused with the presynaptic membrane, then it liberates its chemical by exocytosis mechanism into the cleft, the synaptic cleft. Whenever neurotransmitter is liberated into the synaptic cleft, the neurotransmitter gently spreads across the cleft. Okay, for this spreading it takes some delay, and after that what happens? The neurotransmitter, after reaching the postsynaptic membrane, it is bound to its own receptor. If ACH is there, ACH receptor. If dopamine, dopamine receptor. Serotonin, such specific receptors are there. So it will go and attach to the receptor. When that chemical attaches to the receptor, then the ligand gated channels will open. When ligand gated channels are opened, already excessive sodium is there outside, sodium will go inside. Okay, if sodium ions are positive ions and if they are going inside the postsynaptic membrane, it causes excitation. It causes depolarization of postsynaptic membrane. When postsynaptic membrane gets depolarized, then EPSPs are generated. EPSP, excitatory postsynaptic potentials. Sorry. And then if some chemicals are there, you take for example some other neurotransmitters, some specific neurotransmitters, of course ACH will also act like that. It will go and bind with the receptor. Okay, this receptor is situated in such a channel, and that channel is not meant for sodium. Earlier it is meant for sodium, so that sodium goes inside and causes EPSP. But this channel, in some synapses, ACH binds with some other channels, where these channels allow potassium to go inside, not sodium. If sodium ions go inside, what happens? Depolarization occurs. Or if potassium ions or chloride ions go inside, instead of depolarization, hyperpolarization occurs. Okay? So when hyperpolarization occurs, the postsynaptic membrane does not reach the threshold value. The depolarizing stimulus does not reach the threshold value, so that no action potential is generated. In such case, all small packets of such stimuli are called IPSPs. IPSP means inhibitory postsynaptic potential. Friends, you just understand, when EPSP is created, information passes. When IPSP is created, information is stopped. So a synapse can regulate the flow of action potential, whether to allow or not to allow, whether to block or to block. Okay, so whether to allow or to block. When action potential, what is generated, liberates the chemicals, and chemicals go and bind with the receptors, and receptors will open channels. What channel it is opening? If it is opening sodium channel, sodium will go and cause depolarization and reaches the threshold value, depolarization of threshold value, so that EPSP, excitatory postsynaptic potential, is created and action potentials are formed in the postsynaptic membrane. If the neurotransmitter binds to a receptor of that ligand-gated channel, which opens to allow potassium ions or chloride ions, then it causes hyperpolarization. Hyperpolarization stimulus does not reach the threshold. That's why action potential cannot be generated. So the information is stopped in the synapse only. Okay, to make you understand, I have drawn here two, graphs. You see here, the upper one is the action potential of presynaptic neuron. Action potential reached to the tip of the presynaptic neuron, this is. And what has happened in the postsynaptic neuron? The lower graph shows the postsynaptic here. The postsynaptic potential reached to the stimulus. This is the stimulus. Reached to the stimulus. This is minus 55. When it reached to the stimulus, it generates action potential. So, this is called EPSP. That means, in the postsynaptic membrane also, action potential generated. Now, let us see the other case. If the neurotransmitter binds to another channel where potassium or chloride goes inside, the potassium or chloride never generate a depolarization potentials which will touch the threshold. You see here, threshold value is here, minus 55, okay, here. But here, the postsynaptic potential, instead of creating depolarization, created hyperpolarization. Because it created hyperpolarization, no action potential is formed in the postsynaptic membrane. That is, the information stopped here. So, synapses are two types. Excitatory synapses, where the information is allowed to pass. Inhibitory synapse, where the information is not allowed to go to the next neuron. It will be stopped here. Okay? Instead of saying excitatory and inhibitory, we need to call it as EPSP and IPSP. Because, you see, these neurotransmitters are going to create small quantified packets of depolarizations. These quantified packets of depolarizations are collectively causing a stimulus. If the stimulus reaches the threshold, then action potential is generated in the next neuron. If all these packets are accumulated, but the value doesn't touch the threshold value, then there will be no action potential in the next neuron. So action potential all or none, that will happen. Okay, it totally depends upon what gates are opening in the postsynaptic membrane. Whether the sodium gates are opening or the potassium or chloride gates are opening. Depending upon that, we can say that whether the action potential crosses the synapse or it is blocked at the synapse. Okay, and this is a very, very important study to understand the synaptic transmission. Synaptic transmissions are two types. One is called the direct transmission. Doesn't mean it is electric synapse. Direct transmission here is having a different meaning. And the other one is called indirect transmission. Direct transmission is that transmission in which a synaptic cleft is having certain, what is that called, ligand gates. And these ligand gated channels, when neurotransmitter comes and touches the ligand-gated channels, directly channels open. Okay, the chemical comes, the chemical is released from the presynaptic neuron, and the chemical goes and touches the postsynaptic membrane. Okay, and in the postsynaptic membrane, receptors are located nearby the gates, so that gates are directly open. There is no second messenger involvement. Second messenger involvement is not there. Okay, so such a case is called direct transmission. Okay, direct transmission never mean, now what is that, electrical synapse. Electrical synapse directly goes. But here transmission occurs in the form of chemicals, and these chemicals are making the channel open directly. Okay, now, okay, let's see. Binding of chemicals allow opening of channels directly. That is the very, very important meaning of direct transmission. The chemicals that are released in small packets, okay, quantified packets, and these packets are, each packet is having a small value. If all the values are added, if the accumulated value is having the strength of a threshold value, then it is called EPSP. If all the values are added, but the value does not reach the threshold, it is called IPSP. Okay? EPSP means depolarization in the next neuron. IPSP means hyperpolarization in the next neuron. Okay, you see EPSP, neurotransmitters go to the postsynaptic membrane to reach the threshold value so that sodium gates are opened. Excitation occurs or depolarization occurs. In the case of inhibitory postsynaptic potentials, neurotransmitter goes to the postsynaptic membrane not to open sodium but to open what? Potassium or chloride. As a result of that, hyperpolarization occurs. Okay, so that is direct. But what is indirect transmission? Indirect transmission means the neurotransmitter does not go and bind with the channel here. Earlier case, neurotransmitter directly went and touched the channel and channel opened. Here, that is not the case. The neurotransmitter here binds to a protein receptor. G-linked protein receptor, this is. G protein receptor. This is not the channel. Okay, you see in the earlier case, directly it bound with the channel. Direct. Here, the neurotransmitter binds to a protein receptor. Okay, whenever the neurotransmitter binds to the protein receptor, the protein gets activated. The activated protein stimulates effector protein. The effector protein, with the help of this G protein releases second messengers and calcium ions. And these second messengers and calcium ions stimulate the effector protein to release an enzyme called protein kinase. This protein kinase makes the channel open, not the neurotransmitter directly opening. Neurotransmitter is opening the channel indirectly by an enzyme. That is why it is called indirect transmission. So when channel opens, the ions go inside and then it will cause either EPSP or IPSP depending upon the quanta. Okay, what are the different steps? Neurotransmitter goes to the protein receptor, G protein gets activated. G protein means GTP dependent protein, so that the internal messengers are liberated. These internal messengers activate certain proteins to form protein kinase. Protein kinase opens the channel, so channel allows the ions to come inside. Ions whether to create the EPSP or IPSP depending upon the strength of the stimulus. Okay, because most of these indirect synaptic transmission is involved in the metabolism, they are called metabotrophic transmission. Okay, this transmission is mediated by receptors, and those receptors are called metabotrophic receptors, and this transmission is called metabotrophic transmission. Okay, now So synaptic transmission and synapse is having a greater dependence with chemicals, and these chemicals are called neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters are the chemicals that are produced by the nerve cells itself, and they are released in the synapse into the synaptic cleft, and they bind with the receptors of the postsynaptic membrane to excite or to inhibit the information or the postsynaptic membrane. Okay, how many different kinds of neurotransmitters are there? Let us learn. There are a number of varieties of neurotransmitters, of which the most common or principal neurotransmitter is acetylcholine, ACH we call acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is the chemical that is liberated into the synapse. It may be excitatory or inhibitory. ACH may be excitatory or inhibitory, dependent upon the synapse at the location of the synapse, or depending upon the nerves. Okay. Now, but when acetylcholine is liberated at a neuromyonal junction or neuromuscular junction or myoneuronal junction or motor end plate, definitely it is excitatory and it stimulates the muscle to contract. It stimulates the muscle to contract. That means it is excitating the muscle to contract. So ACH is always excitatory when it is released in myoneuronal junctions. And wherever acetylcholine is liberated, there are its receptors. In that postsynaptic membrane, its receptors are there. Such receptors are called cholinergic receptors. Such synapses are called cholinergic synapses. Such nerve endings are called cholinergic nerve endings. Such nerve fibers are called cholinergic fibers. Depending upon the liberation of neurotransmitter, this nomenclature comes. Okay, it may be excitatory or inhibitory, but in most of the cases we will find acetylcholine. And certain neurotransmitters are amino acids. They are gamma amino butyric acid, GABA, we call GABA. GABA stands for gamma amino butyric acid. This is always inhibitory. Gamma amino butyric acid and glycine, always inhibitory. Okay, and you see the glutamate, it is also a kind of what is that called, neurotransmitter. And this glutamate is specifically involved in learning and memory related functions of neurons. Okay, whenever a neuron wants to learn something, or whenever we learn something, that will be relative permanent way they are stored in our nervous system. For example, you have learned swimming, you have learned a language, you have learned how to ride bicycle. Okay, so these are all the behavioral patterns, okay, which a changed behavioral patterns that are stored in a relative permanent manner in our nervous system. Nervous system is nothing but neurons. And how the learning occurs? The learning occurs by making a specific contact with other neurons. That is called synapse. In such a case, glutamate is playing a very, very important role. Okay? Glutamate is responsible for the onset of the behavior, what we have learned, and memory reactions also. It is always excitatory. Okay? If you want to memorize something, or if glutamate is liberated, we'll get that one. Okay? Next, glycine is always inhibitory, and aspartate is always excitatory. And also we have some other neurotransmitters like biogenic amines. Biogenic amines are nothing but epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, serotonin. Epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, and serotonin. Okay, so what are these? Epinephrine. Okay, it is epinephrine is there. Let me correct once. 1 minute. Okay, this is epinephrine. Okay, epinephrine. Yes, I have not. Okay, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, and these are all epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, and serotonin. These are biogenic amines actually. Okay. These epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, these three are derived from tyrosine, whereas serotonin is derived from tryptophan. Okay, serotonin, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, these are all biogenic amines. Okay, epinephrine and norepinephrine not only acting as neurotransmitters, they are also acting as hormones. They are called catecholamines. These are called catecholamines. They act as neurotransmitters and they also act as what is that called, hormones. Okay, this is nothing but adrenaline. Such nerves are called adrenergic nerves, adrenergic synapses. Cholinergic earlier, this is adrenergic. Okay, dopamine and serotonin are produced in brain by some nerve cells. Dopamine and serotonin, and this dopamine and serotonin will affect the sleep, the mood changes of our body, the attention, and they are also responsible for learning something. So if you want to learn something, dopamine will be liberated. If you want to show attention, dopamine will be liberated. And for sleep, serotonin is playing a very, very important role. So they are also neurotransmitters regulating the mechanism in our cerebral cortex and in some other parts of our brain. Okay. And some neurotransmitters are completely in gaseous state. They are nitrous oxide NO, carbon monoxide CO. Nitrous oxide is very, very important because it relaxes the smooth muscles, it dilates the blood vessels, and it will give you the relief from angina pectoris, the chest pain, and it will inhibit the blood clotting in the blood vessels. They are called thrombotic events. So the persons who are at risk of cardiac arrest will take this one, nitric oxide. Okay. Next, carbon monoxide. Very strangely, carbon monoxide is a dangerous gas, but it is having some regulation over hypothalamic hormones. And it will slow down the contraction of intestinal smooth muscles. And for some kind of reproductive activities also, carbon monoxide is showing certain effect. Okay, next. Neurotransmitter irregular. Sometimes neurotransmitters may be released in more quantities or in less quantities. What happens if they are released in very less quantities? When they are released in very less quantities, we'll get Alzheimer's, the memory loss. And if they are secreted in excessive quantities, person gets schizophrenia. The schizophrenia is a disease where thinking, feeling, behaving will be affected. Okay. Once a neurotransmitter is liberated into the synapse, how it is vacated from the synapse, that is very, very important. Otherwise, what happens if the neurotransmitter is permanently settled in the synaptic cleft, it will go on causing excitations or it will go on causing inhibition. So whatever neurotransmitter that is liberated into the synaptic cleft must be removed immediately after the function is over. Okay, how it is removed, how it is terminated, let us see. So termination of chemical transmission. In some cases, in some synapses, the neurotransmitter simply diffuses out of the synapse, so that the synapse is kept ready for the next transmission. And in some synapses, okay, neurotransmitter may be taken back into the presynaptic bulb by an active transport. Okay, you see here there is a mechanism. The neurotransmitter what is not used or what has completed its function will go back, actively pumped into the presynaptic bulb, and they get stored, packaged into the synaptic vesicles again. Okay, so that is one way of removing the neurotransmitter from the synapse. And you see the glial cells, the supporting cells. The glial cells may take up the neurotransmitter and use it for burning purpose or for fuel. and ACH, that is very, very important. ACH, acetylcholine, is always degraded by an enzyme action that is called acetylcholine esterase. When this acetylcholine esterase is there, the liberated acetylcholine will be metabolized. Okay? Friends, you might have understood today's lesson of synapse, synapse structure, synaptic transmission, types of synapse, and neurotransmitters, and several other things. Thank you, and thank you for watching this video lesson.